Welcome to Real Food. When we have to prepare a big celebration dinner for either a holiday, birthday, or anniversary, we need a big dish to center the meal around. The main dish we'll be serving up today is two delicious roasts. First, I'm going to show you how to prepare a stuffed loin of pork, followed by roasted chicken scaparello. So no matter when you should stop by my home, no matter where you are, stop by sometime, look in my freezer, and there will always be these little loins of pork. These are so versatile, and they're great if you have surprise guests. They're great for friends and family. They do a great job. Now, you certainly could get a big, giant roast pork, have the butcher take the bone out. There's a lot of things you can do here with this meal I'm going to do today. But this is kind of a simple thing, and I like these simple roasts. You know, a lot of times we're afraid of our ovens. We're afraid of this stuff. We do everything in frying pans. This is a great meal for, like, a Sunday. Matter of fact, I make this a lot of times for my dad too. So what you would do with this roast is you take it out of the package, of course. You drain it out a little bit, and then what I literally did is I butterflied it. So I just kind of opened it up, and it makes like a beautiful large piece of roast. So I'm going to show you how large it is. I had it wrapped in plastic here just to kind of keep it fresh. Look at the size of this, right? It's great. So I kind of have this big piece, and I'm going to overlap it a little bit. And then what we're going to do is just kind of stuff this down a little bit, and then we'll roast it. It'll be a delicious lunch for your family. This is not a bad Sunday thing. Now, when I was a kid, you know, and this is God's blessings on our lives, how it changes over time. You know, when I was a kid, this was just part of it, right? We would have pasta, too, and maybe a soup. So this was all part of this giant meal we would have on Sunday. Now, if I make this for my dad, you know, this is our meal. This is what we have on Sunday. This is the thing we have. So what I'm going to stuff it with, because I had it, is some beautiful fresh prosciutto di Parma. So this is delicious, absolutely wonderful. So I'm not going to go too crazy with it, but I'm going to put some prosciutto di Parma here. Now, you know, you could kind of go with any one of a number of things in here, you know, and kind of see what you want to use. This makes a beautiful stuffing, though, and it cooks beautiful in the oven, too. So I don't know if you ever think about cooking with prosciutto, right? But if you get it cut a little thick and you put, you know, you kind of pan fry a little bit before you make your tomato sauce, absolutely delicious. So don't let, you know, prosciutto just be this snack you just eat, but it's got a lot of other potential, too, to just kind of enjoy it. So here we go. Put this on. I like to make a roast. Like I said, I don't know, roasts used to be very popular, but not so much anymore, right? But I still think it's a great meal, and it's a great Sunday meal. So I have all my, that's my prosciutto. Now, here we go. I got some cheese that I had in the fridge. This is like a fontina, so I'm just going to cut a couple of pieces of this. And I'm going to line right down the middle here with some nice cheese. And you got to remember, this will all melt together and be absolutely delicious and wonderful. So there we go. And then the only other thing I think I might add is a little bit of Italian parsley, because Italian parsley is delicious. This is sort of the end of the season of my plant here, so I don't have too much left to offer. Some gave all. This one gave all, that's for sure. How do you cook at home? Do you use fresh herbs? Do you use dried herbs? I like dried herbs, too, but I tell you the truth, there's nothing quite like some fresh herbs, so I like to try to keep them growing in the backyard. I cut them back and get as many plantings as I can out of these. So there, that's pretty good. Put some of this on. You kind of see where I'm going, right? This looks delicious. And we're going to season the outside and the inside of this. So that's kind of part of the fun of this. The inside here, a little bit of black pepper. Okay, and that should just about do it. Now, tying this up. Here's the part of this which gets kind of confusing. There are all kinds of techniques for tying pork. Now, I have here, this is what I call Gilligan's Island tying. So say you don't have any twine at home, and you say, oh, Martina, what can I do? I don't have any twine. I don't know where you buy twine. Well, you just get the old aluminum foil, and this works great as a twine. So if you don't have anything else, like, you know, Gilligan's Island, they used everything they had to live. This is something you could use. Otherwise, just get some lengths of rope of twine. And you don't have to keep it all together and tie it up beautiful. I'm going to show you just a very simple way to do it, and we'll do it this way as I talk to you, too. So I'm going to start by kind of moving that in. Try to get this to fold over, like so. And these moments, like I said, with family, like, you never quite forget this, do you? These moments of coming together and having the meal and sharing with one another. I kind of love this, and Again, I have great memories of my mom doing this on Sundays and, you know, just a beautiful meal. This doesn't have to be overly pretty, by the way, either. You know, I mean, for you, I should probably do it nicer than I am, but it's okay. This works fine. Go over a little bit. I want to speak about my Irish grandmother for a minute today. I was thinking of her earlier today. You know, it's interesting, like, so many of you know me for my Italian heritage, because that's what I cook on television. But my dad, you know, has an Irish mom and a Dutch dad from the West Indies, from St. Martin in the West Indies. So, interesting about that, my grandmother, my Nana Anna, as I call her affectionately, she was a woman who made a lot of roasts, you know, and we would go to her house, and she would have made a big ham, or she'd make a big roast pork. It was just wonderful to have her in our lives and to have that Irish culture, too, that Irish heritage, which sometimes would get gobbled up by all the Italian heritage around. You know, we lived in a two-family home, and my grandparents, my Italian grandparents, lived upstairs. So we kind of lived the Italian way, if you will, and we did a lot of life living that way. So you see what I'm doing here, right? You kind of basically have this. Here's the last tie. And once I tie this off, I'm going to do one other thing to this meat. I'm going to give it a little bath in olive oil because olive oil will help season it. Olive oil will help to brown it. It'll be delicious. So just give it a little bit of a bath in olive oil. I'm doing this on a cutting board. You might want to do this, you know, over a plastic cutting board, acrylic. You just kind of roll it in itself. Looks great. Looks terrific. Then the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put some salt on this, on the outside. Okay. And then the other thing I want to do is we're going to liberally put black pepper on here because this will form like a bit of a crust and you'll be glad you did it. So this is not, and again, not hard to do. I think people are afraid of roasts. These are not hard to do. They're an easy meal. And really very enjoyable for the family. And when you slice this, like later on when I slice this, when it's all done, you're going to see just a beautiful, beautiful roast. And again, you could make thicker, thinner. I like this thin roast. I really do. So let me get this onto the cooking tray, like so. Now, if it doesn't fit straight, you just kind of go with the angle there and make it work that way. Because how you cook this is how it will stay. So that's kind of going to be how it's going to be. I like a hot oven in the beginning. I like almost like a 375, 400 degree oven in the beginning. You get the thing browned up. Then you can reduce it down again and everything else. Now you say, well, what do you serve with this? Well, you know, one of the interesting things for my own grandparents, something that was kind of important back in the day, is, you know, everything that went on the side. One of the things that they would do is polenta with this. So polenta is a wonderful... You know, some people call it mush. It's cornmeal, right? And cornmeal that is slowly cooked with stock and some cheese. And if you cook it and you can eat it warm, it's sort of like mush. But if you put it into some kind of form pan, if you put it into a loaf pan, it hardens up a little bit. You can slice it. And then just a little pan fry of that is absolutely delicious with this. So it's a great great way to have a meal. Kind of do it that, you know, kind of traditional way. Is this Italian style? Well, with the prosciutto and the cheese in it, it is, right? So even though we're talking about my Irish grandmother, there's an Italian style here too in this. So we're gonna bake this off. We'll see how this goes. Let it go for a little bit. And then when we get back, I'm going to do this other thing, this roasted chicken scappariello, which is an interesting way to think about it. A lot of times chicken scappariello is done on the stove top. We're going to do it in the oven. Absolutely delicious. So stick around. More real food to come.
The Catholic Faith Network Green Room was provided by Lane Office, your workspace built with integrity.
So chicken scappariello. Now, we have that in our local Italian restaurants. Hopefully in your town, there's a little pizzeria with an Italian restaurant in the back that you love to go to. I have a couple of those, boy, in my life, and I just love it because, you know, it's like going to Cheers, some place where everybody knows your name, they're glad you came. The local places are so great, and the food is so terrific in these places. If you can't find one, go look because there's something out there. So chicken scappariello is sort of like a staple in Italian restaurants, particularly in these little pizzeria restaurants as well, which have, like I said, great food. I'm going to do a roasted one. So it's a little bit different, and it's a little different on purpose because it gives some different flavors. So I have a pan here, and it's getting pretty hot. So I'm going to bring it up a little bit, get it a little bit hotter yet. And what we want to do is we want to brown up some stuff, and then we're going to put this all in the oven and bake it off. So it's a little bit different than average. Most chicken scaparello has these basic ingredients. So this is some sausage. So I'm just going to cut some pieces of sausage up fast and put these in. You know, it's a good thing to also know your sausage. I know that sounds crazy, but to know where you buy your sausage, you know? Where do you get the ingredients that you feed your family, you know? Sometimes the generic, maybe you can get away with the generic. Other times, there's nothing quite like getting the quality, you know? And that's kind of what I find in my own life, that I love to kind of look for the quality stuff. I was just at, I'll give them a plug, I was at A&S Pork Store in Oceanside. Terrific food, terrific homemade stuff. They were making sausage while I was in there. So it was kind of exciting to watch the process, and it brought me back to my own grandpa. So I'm going to make like a smaller serving here, maybe two people. We'll see how it goes. I won't use all of it. And then I'm going to put a piece of onion in here too. And the idea is we want to get things in there that will caramelize, right? So when you do that, everything kind of gets sweeter. So an onion caramelizing is obviously going to be a lot sweeter than a regular onion, like if I eat it right now, of course. And also even the sausage, too. We want that to caramelize, too. That's an important part of this. And what's nice about this is it's a very, what I call like a very forgiving meal. So what we're doing today is something you can do for your family and just kind of, you can't really make a big mistake, to be honest with you. It's so delicious and you can't really make a giant mistake with this. So it'll kind of all work out in the end, you know. The sausage is just starting to come up to the frying, beautiful smells. I'm going to cut some nice big chunky pieces of onion here. We're going to put those in the pot, too. Now, they start off big, of course, but they get small as time goes on. And then I had in the fridge, and it's the same kind of thing. Like, what do you think? What's a good thing that you like to cook with? I love cooking with celery, so I'm going to make some pieces of celery. This is kind of a hearty winter, delicious, cold night meal. And it also holds up well, too, by the way. So, like, you could keep this in the fridge for a couple of days and kind of enjoy. So, get this going here. This is probably enough. Here we go. I'll make them nice and chunky. And put these guys in, too. So, all the hard pieces of stuff are going to go in together here. Then I'm also going to put some carrots. Carrots are going to obviously sweeten everything up. So, you definitely want to put some carrots in. Now, again, I like all of these raw vegetables, these are terrific things to have in. They're great snacks, right? Like if you're really desperate, like you get one of those moments and you say, I'm going to eat this bag of chips. A couple of carrots kind of go well, you know, they get you on the other side. Because, you know, the junk stuff is what really is harmful to us. So if we can get some good food in us, all the nutritionists tell me all the time, just try to eat the good food and less carbs, right? But when you love carbs, it's not easy. I know, it's not easy at all. So I have some carrots here. Put these guys in too. Maybe a little bit more. I'm just eyeballing this. We will have this on the website, so it'll be real on the website. This was one that, like I said, my grandmother used to make. It was a funny thing. When I was a kid, I wouldn't eat stew, you know? But if they called it cacciatore, I would eat it. And that's the same thing. But they always referred to this as, you know, beef or chicken cacciatore, and then it was a fine thing. I don't know why it was like that, but I was. So here we go. You can see everything just starting to roast up a little bit. Give it a little start. And this will actually cook down. And what's going to happen here is it's going to actually form its own kind of soup, because it's going to make the vegetable soup, and a little bit of the fat from the sausage will do that as well. Now we're going to put our chicken. Of course, that's another main ingredient. The chicken's going to go in last. I just got to get a couple more things in. So I have some nice potatoes here. These are kind of those little new potatoes, and these are nice. You know, you got to decide how big you want them to be. I'm just going to cut them in half, and I think this is just a perfect size. And again, we're kind of cooking for two people here. We may be cooking for a little bit more. We'll see how it goes in the end. I'm looking now. Okay. You can hear the sizzling. A little more potato. Carbohydrates. Got to have plenty of these, right? All right. I'm going to put these in too. Now, I pre-washed all of this stuff, so it's easy. We don't have to worry about it. Get it all in. Now, the thing that's not in here yet, as it's starting to sizzle, what's not in here is any salt or any pepper yet. I'm going to do that at the very end, because we have a few other ingredients to add in here. So if you notice, it's starting to make that sizzly noise, which you like. That's exactly what you want. And it should, the sausage should get a little bit caramelized. That's good. And then we'll move toward the chicken. So, you know, what's the best chicken to put in there? Well, not this, believe it or not. I love chicken on the bone because chicken on the bone has a beautiful flavor and it stays moister. What I had some chicken breasts. So you make do with what you have, right? That's what we all do in our lives. And God asks us to do the very reality with the gifts we've been given, right? To thrive and use the gifts we've been given. So what we have right now is some chicken, you know, like I said, just some chicken breasts that are boned. So we're just going to use that. I'm going to salt them up a little bit on both sides. You don't get a second chance at salting and peppering these. So you want to be relatively liberal with this because it's going to get dissipated in that big roasting pan or that roasting dish we have, right? And then I'm going to put a little bit of red pepper because it is going to have an Italian flavor a little bit. Good. Okay. And then the only other thing I may do is just kind of cut it down to size a little bit. Now, if I was making, you know, thighs, I might put whole thighs in. But if I was doing, you know, legs, I try to keep them cuttable size, that kind of thing. These are not tiny, you know, but they're just going to be kind of the size of some of the veggies I have in there, so they're not all different sizes. Oh, there you go. I'm going to put, like I said, all four of them in there. Do you eat a lot of chicken? I think a lot of people today eat a lot of chicken. I know I do, too. It's a great, great, great thing. You know, I told a lot of people, you know, my grandfather was a butcher. And because he was a butcher, we had a lot of meat around all the time. But we really always ate a lot of chicken. The chicken was always an important part of our diet. We always had a lot of chicken in our lives. And the other thing that was great, and I guess this is a privilege, you know, that a lot of people don't really have, is I got to grow up like eating with my grandparents all the time, you know, to kind of grow up with their grandparents. But I've been very blessed in that, you know, that my childhood is such a strong memory. When I meet some of you out there, you'll say to me, what a blessing in your life that you have this gift of remembering your grandparents so well. You know, I don't remember mine. And I say, oh, I remember mine, that's for sure. And what a tremendous gift they are, you know, it's just terrific. So I'm going to just move this over so I can do some more work over here. So we'll get the chicken in there. And I'm not overly worried about the stirring right now because when the onions get down and everything else kind of gets down, it'll all fit in beautifully. That's great. Now, the last thing I'm going to add is a couple other little ingredients just to add to make a little bit of a sauce for this. So I have some white wine here. And, you know, the white wine, although I use, all of you who know me know I don't drink. I just never, ever was a person who drank. Isn't that odd? Well, again, I always thank God for different gifts in our lives. So, you know, you put a little bit of wine in. Something you would enjoy drinking. Because sometimes people will say to me, as a matter of fact, on another episode of our show, I think I cooked with Santa Margherita Pinot Grigio. We got some letters, people saying, how could you use that terrific wine to cook on the show? Well, you know what? It's the wine that people love to drink. Why wouldn't you cook with the wine you love to drink? And then I have some of the juice of the gods here, this beautiful chicken stock. You know, I make that with Carlo's chicken. Carlo Formazano from La Pera Brothers in Brooklyn, and he brings me these parts that they would otherwise discard, and I make the chicken stock from that. So you just about want to fill it up a little bit. Now, if you notice, for this particular recipe, I didn't put any garlic in here, right? Could you put garlic in here? Sure, if you wanted to, you could put a couple of cloves of garlic smashed and take them out later. I didn't want to put any garlic in because I didn't want to mix up the flavors because there's one final flavor I'm going to put on the top that I really want to kind of let seep in, and that's this thyme over here. So this is, again, from my backyard herb garden. This is the thyme, and thyme is pretty good because it grows like a weed, and it smells just wonderful. It has like a little bit in the family of oregano, but a little sweeter than oregano. So let me just cut a little bit off. Here we go, right over here. If you keep this in a sunny window, this is all you need. You know, this will stay with you. You get this well into the fall. So what I'm going to do is actually put, I'm going to put the thyme on the top here because there's going to be a lot of steaming in the future of this. There's going to be a lot of steaming because as soon as I can get this up to a boil, I'm going to put this in the oven too, and it's going to go off in the oven around $350, $375, and we keep it in there till everything's bubbling and it all looks delicious, and it's a terrific stew, it's a terrific meal, and then we might take the cover off at the end, let some of the juices evaporate and get more intense, you know? So this is a great family meal. It's a meal to kind of come together with. What I like about these enamel pots, you know, you have to save your money to buy an enamel pot, but once you have one, you know, you can serve your meals in it and stuff, and that's what I like about it. It's like a one-pot meal, so it doesn't take that much to kind of get the meal together, because you have everything in one pot, you put the one pot on the table, and you're all set. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cover this, and I'm going to let it come up to a boil. While that's going on, one of you will take a little break. You watch this, I'll watch that. We'll be back, and we'll be tasting some stuff, so stick around. More real food to come. Well, two really beautiful recipes. And you know why I think they're good to do on real food is because you can't eat this alone, right? You have to have this with other people. So even if you live alone right now, or your relatives or your family members are far away, invite some neighbors over and have a meal together. If you aren't, well, get the family over on a Sunday and bring back the Sunday dinner. There's something great about that, you know? We are family to one another. We are a community of faith. There's something important about recognizing that faith family that we have that matters so much. I know for my dad, being involved in the parish means everything to him. And he goes and volunteers in outreach, and he has some great friends there. And that's a wonderful gift to a guy who's lost his wife, you know? There's something important about that in our lives, that when we're alone, other people bring us together and we feel kind of in a community, even though in that sense we're still mourning a loss of somebody we love so much. If that's you, that's a great thing to do. These recipes help us to do that, because you can't eat a roast alone. I mean, it's just too big to eat alone. Look at all this pork. I need to share it with some people. So I'm going to look around and gather a table of people and see who I can get together. Whenever we make a roast, whenever we roast this roasted chicken scarpariello, looks great too. The whole point is to recognize coming together and the power of the table, and how when we gather around the table, something happens. You know, what happens is family. What happens is faith. What happens is hope and love, and all those things matter so much. So don't ever sell short the power of the table. The power of the table in your home, where family is discussed and traditions are passed on, and also the family of many other places, other tables where we eat, the tables of restaurants, the tables of those little pizzerias with the restaurants in the back, and the tables in college, et cetera, et cetera. All those tables are part of who we are, and we're called to celebrate those things. We talked all about roasting today. First, we made a stuffed loin of pork. It was stuffed with prosciutto and a wonderful cheese and a little thyme in there and a little parsley in that one. Delicious, absolutely fantastic. And then we also made a roasted chicken scarpariello that had some thyme in it as well. We discussed the importance of celebrations and how they play a part of our life. We commemorate the little things in life, you know, as well as the more important events that take place. As Catholics, we live a life of faith and celebrate the sacraments together often, and we often invite our family and friends to take part in those special celebrations in the lives of those we love. Whether it be a family wedding, which I was just at, a christening, or a first Holy Communion, all of us come together to rejoice in our faith. And so we thank the Lord for the gift of faith and the gift of one another. Let us pray. God of all blessings, source of all life, giver of all grace, we thank you for the gift of life and for the breath that sustains us, for the food of this earth and the family that nurtures us, the people we gather around the table with, and the many ways we share and pass on tradition. Bless our families and all of our traditions, and keep us close to you always. Amen. Thanks for joining us today. For a copy of the recipes in this show, you can email us at realfood@cfntv.org. We'll see you next time, everybody, on Real Food.
Msgr Food and its brand Vantia are proud to support Real Food. Find Vantia cheese, cured meats, olive oil, and Italian specialty foods in your local supermarket, or email us at info@msgrfood.com for a list of retailers near you. Real Food Set and Appliances has been provided by Chufo Cabinetry, a family tradition of fine woodworking since 1907. Chufo Cabinetry has been filling the custom cabinetry needs of the New York tri-state area for over 100 years by combining old-world techniques with modern technology to provide the finest custom kitchens and millwork. Luxury appliance innovators Sub-Zero, Wolf, and Cove. Cosentino, a Spanish company world leader in the production and distribution of innovative surfaces for architecture and design. Silestone, Decton, and Sensa by Cosentino, technologically advanced surfaces that allow the creation of unique designs for the home and public spaces. Blackman Plumbing Supply. Visit a Blackman showroom today and let their specially trained design consultants help you find the luxury plumbing, tile, lighting, and stone products you need to make your project a success. Top Knobs, the designer's choice.